Our theme, Subverting Surveillance, names what we have conceptualized as a platform for reflection and for action. It frames this conference as an opportunity to grapple with the ever-expanding webs of surveillance that we are currently witnessing, from prisons to parks to our personal electronic devices, as well as for strategizing on tactical and insurgent ways of hacking surveillance practices for resistance and self-defense.
So to begin, I have a few slides, and I also want to say that we're not working in a chronological order, so Jordan took us into the past, I'm going to talk more about the present. Christina's going to dip us down into the late 18th and early 19th century, and then I think Marianne will bring us back into the 21st century. So don't think that this is going to build to a ta-da, teleological revelation of what is to be done. It's not. But it is going to be, I hope, a revelation. So three preliminary points and then my provocation. The first is that abolition requires that we change one thing, which is everything. Everything. So when one says prison abolition, one cannot only be talking about prison. That doesn't mean anything. Abolition is not absence, it is presence. And indeed, what the world will become already exists in fragments and pieces, in experiments and possibilities. So those who feel in their gut deep anxiety that abolition means we knock it all down, do scorched earth, and then start something new, let that go. That's not what it is. It's building the future from the present in all of the ways we can, in what we call non-reformist reform. The second is to remind everyone that racial capitalism is all of capitalism. There is not 1 minute in the history of capitalism, not 1 minute, that was not racial. And that means, write this down, that means that if indeed, as many have argued, the capitalism we experience today had its origin and early development in rural England, then the relationships between and among the people in that rising capitalist system, all of whose ancestors might have become white, was already racial. Following that? And if you want to review that, you can read Abolition, Geography, and the Problem of Innocence. It is repeated there by me. And the third thing I want to say as preamble to my ambling is that when we think about the state, we are also then necessarily thinking over and over again about racial capitalism, and we're also thinking over and over again about the social relations through which value is produced, both the value that becomes appropriated by capitalists, but also all of the use values that make life livable and joyful, all of that. So capital state labor, or capital state households, or capital state, all of those social relations is what we're talking about. So when we talk about the state, we must, some of our colleagues and comrades discussed last night, especially Nandita, we must be wary of fetishizing the state. Fascists fetishize the state for a whole set of purposes. And anti-fascists also have a tendency to fetishize the state. And I'm not an anarchist either. Watch out for fetishizing the state. The state doesn't think. The state doesn't think and do. The people enliven the state to think and do. If that were not true, I wouldn't be wasting your time and mine talking. All right, so a few more things to say. This is an artifact. It's not information, so don't worry that you can't read it. And some years ago, maybe 8 or 9 years ago, the New York State Terrorism Intelligence Unit submitted their regular report to the leadership of NYPD discussing the kinds of terrorist threats that they encountered and sought to bring to the leadership's attention in the period of about 1 week. So we're talking about 7 days of terrorism activities. Terrorism activities included, as people who are based in New York and others probably know by now very well, Muslim student organizations at the City University of New York, which is where I teach. Muslim students going camping and praying together. The terrorism information or intelligence unit also covered the fact that Jordan Flaherty, fantastic journalist and activist out of New Orleans, was coming to New York. They also covered the fact that people were organizing because a verdict was coming out concerning the police killing of a young man called Sean Bell, and they expected that there would be action, oppositional and dismayed action and protests. Other things were in this 1 week list. And I show you this artifact so that we can think about the fact that they, the people who enliven the agencies and policies and institutions that we call the surveillance state, are thinking about all of us all the time together. They're already doing that. This is not something that we have to figure out how to do on our own. They got that. So what do we not have to counter the counterinsurgency? So surveillance requires, of course, technology. It requires categories. It requires categories. It depends on certain kinds of subjectivities. And in this era of neoliberal racial capitalism, it also requires a certain ideological normalization, or put that in other words, common sense acceptance. The devolution, making things smaller and smaller and smaller, is a good and natural thing, right? So at the same time that there's increased centralization of the capacities to surveil, to exclude, to punish, to reward, indeed, there's also the notion that states' rights are back, that counties in the United States, there are 3,100 counties, that counties ought to be doing the major determination about criminalization and punishment that the states have taken over for the last 35 or 40 years, and so forth. And what has happened to us is that we have absorbed these norms as though they were actually the only way that life could be lived. And we have devolved ourselves and then wonder where our allies are. This happens over and over and over again. We say, this is my issue, these are my people, this is my vulnerability, this is how I am anxious about the likelihood of premature death. Now, who can I be in alliance with? I suggest to you that thinking that way is thinking in the dominant mode, and therefore undoing the dominant mode will be impossible. It is a militarized way of thinking when we think in terms of allies. Because when we think in terms of allies, then what we're thinking is that at the end of the war, these allies will go back to their place, and these allies will go back to their place, and these allies will go back to their place, i.e. nation-state ideology, territorialized ideology, and a fundamental, as it were, biological separation, whatever kinds of differences we are concerned to liberate. In other words, one of the problems that I think has been ripe for critique and undoing is the problem of confusing difference and the important distinctions of difference, which is to say, what distinctions matter when we assert happily or with fear the differences that we have come together to discuss at this fantastic conference. Where am I with my 2 minutes? I have two. That's great. That's great. So what I suggest we do is take surveillance into ourselves and think about surveillance, which is the systematic observation and study of whatever the object is we are systematically observing and studying, and put it together with surveying. This guy in the middle with his armed comrades is Amilcar Cabral, who you all know was a revolutionary, who was one of the leaders, intellectual and political leaders of the PAIGC, the political party that waged the 13-year hot revolution in Guinea-Bissau in South Tomé. And their work, as we learned from Sonia Vachaborges, a fantastic intellectual who's a postdoc down at CUNY, was to figure out how to make society completely anew. But they made it from what was, not from what didn't exist yet. And yet, they changed how, for example, education had meaning and how gender had meaning and so forth. But what Cabral did, as this one did, was walk the land. Cabral had been trained to be a member of the professional managerial class of the colonial state. He was an agronomist. He knew the dirt. He knew it better than almost anyone else. And although he had been educated by the Portuguese state to figure out how to make the dirt of Guinea-Bissau more productive for Portuguese racial capitalism, what he did in doing his studies and doing his surveying and his surveillance was to figure out what was needed and what was possible to liberate that land. Similarly with Harriet Tubman, as she went out over and over and over again, both as a thief, just having stolen herself, helped other people steal themselves, but also as a spy, working for the Union Army in a way that operationalized a tool of what could become oppressive again and would, in order to achieve something in excess of the future that the Union Army likely had in mind for black people in the South. I will sit down now after showing you this image, which is by the artist, geographer, revolutionary Trevor Paglen. This picture is called Invisible. That's the title. And what he did in developing this picture was try to figure out how to use the tools of geography, the tools of surveillance, and the tools of surveying to figure out where all of the US military black sites were in the United States and on the planet, and photograph them to show us what we otherwise couldn't see. But for me, this picture also has strong metaphorical value in that I imagine it to be actively and antagonistically the contradiction to what it represents, and therefore it is a picture of us coming to meet ourselves in the abolitionist future. Thank you. We have a tendency to default to definitions and understandings of freedom and liberty that are essentially capital L liberal. And I mean liberal like from the books. I don't mean that person thinks they're not a racist because they're not rude to me on the subway. Not that liberal. So Nikhil Singh has a new book about this, which is terrific, called Race in America's Long War. But it goes all the way back. I mean, it goes back and back and back. But you can go back and read Locke's Second Treatise and see all of this unfolding. And if you don't have the patience to read the Second Treatise, read Robinson Crusoe and you'll get the same story. They're written about the same time and with the same concerns. So in Robinson Crusoe, who's sovereign? It's Robinson, right? It's Robinson. And Robinson's entire consciousness as the entrepreneurial individual is supposed to captivate the minds of every seventh grader who reads that book. And what the seventh graders don't notice, because very few teachers of Robinson Crusoe point this out. Certainly I didn't encounter this when I was in the seventh grade, which was 1962. And that is that Robinson Crusoe had a plantation. Like all this alone on the desert island crap, and then he runs into Friday and the footsteps and all that, he had a plantation. And somebody was holding the profits from his plantation in trust for him, in Lisbon actually, which is where I live now, until such time as he came back to life because he had disappeared from them. So what I wonder then in saying this is whether we might not ask ourselves if looking to the details of formal liberalism is not a waste of our time, and that we might better look to the details of other forms already existing that Christina talked about and Jordan talked about and Marianne was pointing toward of freedom that matter and don't go back to the hierarchy and certain kinds of distinctions of difference that we're trying to get out of. So that's my thought of your first question.
You know, I've been really compelled by this comment that Supreme Court Justice Sandra Sotomayor made in her dissenting opinion of the 2014 case Utah versus Strife. As she's talking about the, not just the mass arrest, but the potential for police to stop and search anybody that they decided might potentially be committing a crime. She described a condition of people feeling like they were, quote, subjects of a carceral state just waiting to be cataloged. And I think, you know, so in answering your first question, Tina, of how do we understand ourselves as subjects in the world in relationship to policing, I think this is a really productive category to think about this other condition of being on the verge. So I really, you know, I really appreciated Miriam's point about calling our attention when we're thinking about policing and surveillance, not just to spectacular acts of violence, but to the mundane, to the ways in which criminalization exists as a condition of possibility, you know, so that anybody can be determined to be either in the process of committing a crime, possessing the intention to commit a crime, escaping from committing a crime, or potentially recruited to commit a crime. You know, in a recent piece I just wrote for this book called Feminists Rethink the Neoliberal State, I was really motivated to think about the case of Daniel Holtzclaw, a police officer in Oklahoma who stalked and raped a number of black women there. And when you read through the depositions of these women, you find that the pretext for those stops was this, Holtzclaw and basically anybody in that police department could pull anybody over and say, I'm just doing a warrant check. And I think that, you know, we need some better spatial language. I think if there's any continuity across this discussion today, it's really thinking differently about space and conditions of being and the ways in which that makes us vulnerable to surveillance, vulnerable to criminalization in a way that is hard to perceive if we just start from the presumption of criminalizations as related to embodied categories, right? These are conditions of possibility. And I guess that relates to the second question about alliances, which is, you know, I appreciate it's a beautiful question and something very dear to my heart. And maybe I'll just say this really briefly. You know, Jordan and I put together Policing the Planet in a real effort to think about solidarity in a broader, more robust way. And I think part of what we were trying to do was to say there's a different kind of solidarity that forms when you don't presume that you already understand like both the subject categories that people inhabit or the forms of repression that the state is deploying against you. And actually by opening up those categories, by thinking about something like broken windows policing, by thinking about surveillance, you actually come to understand that there are you know, both a number of ways that we're imagined to be working together, and there are a number of ways that that repression already unites us. And so, you know, for me, thinking about solidarity, you know, as something that could approach the way that the state is afraid that we are united. If we can think about solidarity in a way that doesn't presume already existing categories of being, if we can think about solidarity as something that unites us because of the ways that we are repressed and watched, then we can develop something that's bigger than I think we have the capacity to imagine at present.
But what has also happened, and this is part, I think, of the normalization of devolution, you know, under neoliberalism, that somehow more local is always better, right? If you can touch the state, it won't hurt you. This young man in Chicago gets touched by the state all the time, and it's not helping him. All right. So, but with this devolution-shaped consciousness, more and more people, especially my experience in this part of North America, so the US and to some degree Canada, I cannot speak to Mexico or the Caribbean, but in this part of North America that I know, people are, for reasons I think of considered self-defense, so that's not a bad thing, are drawing boundaries around themselves, their categories, their organizations, their concerns, and their goals. And then considering whether and to what extent and under what circumstances they will join into something most normally in my experience called alliance with others. This to me is thinking through the configuration of the nation state and militarism. That's what I think. And I can't get away from it. So the hard thing here, acknowledge this, the hard thing here is to imagine and imagine again how those distinctive forms of difference, right, how those distinctive forms of difference can enable, I'm going to use Christina's word because I like it, can enable solidarity rather than insist on particularity. Right? This is, and it's hard, I understand it. But I could give some examples. In the early 2000s in California, a group of us were trying to stop the state of California from building and opening its 25th new prison, mega prison, 24th, lost track. And the prison, like all of the new prisons that California built since the mid-1980s, was going to be in a rural town in central California. California's big, you know, gigantic. So we organized and organized and organized and organized to try to stop this prison. Since there were basically six of us, we couldn't do it on our own. But the way that we could make solidarity with people who might not think that criminalization and incarceration was in the cards for them was to understand, as Cabral and his comrades did, or as Tubman did, certainly not working alone, although we always picture her alone, to imagine what the terrain of struggle was for people who were there in that region, right? So it is, as Christina says, spatial, it's territorial, and one thing that we took very much to heart, and I've only just recently started describing this way, is understanding their territories of selves, which is what comes out of the capital L liberal sovereignty way of being in the world. And the way it worked out, and this is going to be in the new edition of Golden Gulag, which will be out next January. The way it worked out was that people already had understandings, and if the questions we asked were better than the questions that we had been asking, we got better answers. So instead of saying, why do you want this prison, we would say, what do you want, right? Instead of saying, do you know somebody who's locked up, although many people did, we said, what do you know about vulnerability? Who's worried? And to what end? So we didn't have to do any of this bipartisan bullshit of making solidarity, this is live streamed, right? Bullshit. With, the right wing of any political party, and I'm pointing fingers at all the political parties for the person who said we didn't take, I'm wearing a red star for a reason, right? That isn't the way to go, but we used every available language, provocation, understanding capitulation to create, in a robust way, an abolitionist geography in Central California. And while we didn't stop that prison, they couldn't do another one. They couldn't do another one. We actually did create, slowly, with labor unions and all these kinds of people, right, an abolitionist geography, which is the antagonistic contradiction of carceral geography. That's what we did. Nobody recognizes it among those who look only to top-down explanations for things, but it gave me some really substantial and visceral understanding of what could be possible. So I hope that answers your question.